Shalom Avachem, I would like to wish you a good week, Be'ezat Hashem. I pray to Hashem to give you happiness, health, Be'ezat Hashem, and a good week. My friend, there is a story about a rabbi, the son of a big tzaddik, and he was as well the student, one of the student of the Gaon Mivilna, who went to immigrate to Israel. And he took the boat, he went with his son and daughter. They were young. And unfortunately, the boat hit a rock. And the boat started to sink. And the rabbi, he knew how to swim. So he took his two children, and he started to swim with them. But he was very tired. He couldn't hold it, both of them. He had no choice. He had to abandon one of them. His daughter was very heavy. And he couldn't. He couldn't use his left hand because his daughter, she was very heavy. He told her, if I carry on holding you, we will sink, the three of us. I can't, you know. It's like he lost his patience, he lost his courage, he couldn't do nothing. She told him, Papa, you cannot do that. You cannot let me down. You are my papa. I have nobody else to ask help from. Please, papa, do your best. Hold me. Don't let me down. His father, her father, when he heard this, suddenly he had more strength and he carried on swimming till they arrived to the end of the sea, and he touched the sand, and then he felt. When he woke up, he told his daughter, "My daughter, you know, if you wouldn't tell me that you are my father, you must help me, you must save me. I have nobody else to ask to. I would have done you, my friend." We have a father, he's Hashem. What we see today, unfortunately, that we suffered in the Shoah and with all the problems that we have, well, we have only one to ask for help. It's Hashem. We have nobody else. Only HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You know, my friend, this week, something extraordinary happened this week. You know, there was a man who came to see me. And this man, he had a lot of problems. So, I know this man, he was a millionaire, he was a big, very rich man. And even the newspapers, they talk a lot about him, that he did a bad business, and then he's losing, and he lost in the market, you know, and he lost his real estate, and really, it was a big problems in the banks. He started to take all his belongings. He even had a private bank. He lost it, and he came. So I told him, look, you did your life as you wanted. Now maybe you have to come back to Hashem. Start eating kasher. Start keeping Shabbat. And he looked at me as a surprised man. He said, what the connection with my business that I'm losing and keeping Shabbat, eating kosher? I don't understand, but I do a lot of tzedakah. I said, okay, tzedakah. It's not your tzedakah. It's Hashem who gives you the money. you give back some of the money tzedakah, but it's not from your pocket. It's from the pocket of God, Hashem. So he couldn't answer me. Now I'm telling you, I'm talking to you. You want Hashem to help you. Do something. You are Jewish, yeah. You believe in the Torah, yes. So, if you believe in the Torah, you have to understand that the Torah said that the Beth Amikdash was destroyed because of the Torah. When the Jews did not respect the Torah, they went to exile and they lost their land. So, if you believe, so I told him, on Simcha Torah, you go to Shul? He said, of course. Do you dance with the Sefer Torah? He said, of course, I always buy the to open the ark with the $200,000, $300,000, and then I buy Aliyah. Sometimes the Aliyah cost me $1 million. So you believe in the Torah. So why it's so hard for you to not to put tefillin, not to keep Shabbat? What is so hard for you? Why it takes so much risk? Do something. And he looked at me like he was not convinced. He said, okay, I came to ask help from you, and I see that you cannot help me. I said, well, I'm sorry if I cannot help you. This is your problem. But what, my friend, 2 days later, I was receiving people. He came again. He said, well, I'm sorry for 2 days ago, and I think I'm going to start listening to your advice because you're right. I said, well, thank you very much. Thank you. So, you listen. My friend, this is now, of course, all of you, we want to know what happened after. Well, all what I can tell you, Baruch Hashem, he's alive, he's a Baruch Hashem, he struggled, but he's okay, thanks God. Sometimes people just don't realize how much Hashem helped them. Because they want to be as they were before. At least Baruch Hashem, they are not what they're supposed to be. But Baruch Hashem, they are not struggling like before. Thanks God. You know, I said a few weeks ago, it was the Hilula of a big tzaddik, Rabbi Hananiah ben Terahiah. Rabbi Hananiah ben Terahiah was among the 10 rabbis that the Roman killed, unfortunately. They killed Rabbi Akiva, and Rabbi Hananiah ben Terahiah was one of them. The Gemara said how the Roman stopped him, because they saw that he was reading the Torah. And the Roman at that time, they forbid the Jews to read the Torah. And they found that Rabbi Hananiah ben Terahiah, he was reading the Torah and he was teaching. So the Roman, they took him, they took his Sefer Torah, and they took the Sefer Torah around him. It's like they made a circle of the Sefer Torah around his body, and they started to burn the Sefer Torah. And when the Sefer Torah will get burned, so of course, Rabbi Hananiah ben Terahiah, he will die, of course. And the Romans were looking, they were enjoying this beautiful, for them, theater that they made. And the Talmidim, the student of Rabbi Akiva, the Roman forced them to come to watch how their rabbi is getting burning with the Sefer Torah. And of course, it was very hard for them to see that. And they took his daughter as well to come to see, to watch. Imagine a daughter watching her father get dying with fire. It's not easy. And the Talmidim, not to waste time, the last moment of life of Rabbi Hananiah ben Terahiah, and they ask him one question, Rabbi, at that moment that they burn you, we see that you accept these sufferings. Can you tell us, what do you see? So he told them, I see the letters of the Sefer Torah flying up. I see the Sefer Torah get burned, but the letters, they're not burned. They are flying. What's the message of this? I mean, just think a little bit. What the meaning of the Sefer Torah is burning, but the letters are not burning? My friend, that was a big message of Rabbi Hanina Beit Radion. I was thinking that Rabbi Hanina Beit Radion wanted to teach his student a last lesson. He couldn't tell them halachot because the Romans were there. Maybe they will kill them. But he told them something, a secret that only a Jew can understand. When a tzaddik passes away, we burn him. He's buried. What about his Torah? His Torah is not buried. His Torah, it's flying. That's what Rabbi Hanina Beit Radion said. They burn me. They burn with me the Sefer Torah. But they don't burn the Torah itself. They burn only the parchment. That's it. A paper. But not the letters. The letters are flying. That means that the Torah remains. Now it's up to you to catch up all what this Torah was in this Sefer Torah. I mean, when you see Sefer Torah get burned, that it doesn't mean that you burn the Torah itself. You burn the Gvirim. You burn the Sefer Torah. The parchment, but not the Torah itself. My friend, my father, Alav Shalom, passed away. But always in my memory, I live his life. I remember the good things he did. So he died, but his Torah, he didn't die. The letters are flying, and I catch them. My grandfather, Rabbi Chaim Pido, Alav Shalom, the Baal Shem Tov, all the tzaddikim, they die. But their Torah is not, it didn't die. They are flying. We catch them. We learn from them. This is something that every one of us should know. My friend, there is a beautiful parasha of Bil'am. Bil'am Arasha, listen to this. Huh? Bil'am Arasha, he wanted to curse the Jews. But Hashem, he didn't need him. He didn't need him to curse the Jews. So he couldn't curse them. He didn't curse the Jews. So he said to Hashem, I want to bless them. And Hashem said, you don't need to bless them because they are blessed. They don't need your bracha. It's like if you ask Hitler, give a bracha to the Jews. You don't like them. You will curse them, you will kill them. So Hashem, he said, don't. But anyway, he said, Hashem, the most important is that I will not curse them. I want to bless them. Okay. So he blessed them. But Bilam, in his mind, it was a bless that it should become a curse. You understand? That was his thought. And the Torah wrote it. And the Torah wrote all the blessing that Bilam blessed the Jews. You know why the Torah wrote it? Because the Torah, it's emet. Because Bilam, when he was blessing, he was thinking bad thoughts on the blessing. So Hashem, he said to Moshe, write his blessing, that all the blessing that he did, I will confirm that there will be a blessing, not a curse. Because the Torah, it's emet. You know, my friends, Baruch Hashem, that Hashem, It told Moshe Rabbeinu to do that. You know why, my friend? Because usually when we see the Jewish people suffering the Shoah, during 2,000 years, we'll be suffering. And even now, we're suffering. We have Eretz Israel, we suffer. You know, my friend, Baruch Hashem, that the blessing of Yitro, of Bilam, they were written in the Torah. Because Bilam, he thought that the blessing will be the contrary. And because the Torah wrote the blessing, so never there will be the contrary. Every time that the nations, they think that's it, we have the last solution for the Jews, something happened for the good of the Jews, and nothing happened at the end. My friend, Bilam, when he saw the Jewish people sitting, respecting Torah mitzvot, respecting Nida, he said, Ma tuvu alecha Yaakov mishkin utecha Yisrael. All the Ashkenazim, all the synagogue, and the Beit HaKnesset, there is this pasuk that Bilam said, Ma tuvu alecha Yaakov mishkin utecha Yisrael. How are beautiful your synagogues, your Beit HaMidrash. Who said that? Bilam. How can you imagine that till now we mention something that Bilam said? I mean, Bilam was a bad man. Bilam wanted to curse the Jews. Bilam, even when he blessed the Jews, he thought that his bless will be the contrary. How can you imagine that? How it's possible to imagine for 1 minute that this pasuk that Bilam said, it will remain. Ma tuvu alecha Yaakov mishkin utecha Yisrael. So Rashi, he said, because at that moment, Bilam, he saw the emet. He saw the reality. He saw the truth. He saw that the Jews, only through the synagogue, only through the Torah, they have success. God with them. So, because in that moment, he saw the reality, so we took it as evidence, as a témoignage, as a testament from Bilam that even that he was Rasha, he wanted to curse the Jews, but this is emet. So because Bilam, he did like a certificate, he testified this, so the Torah wrote it in the Torah. My friend, this is Gvilin Nisrafin Beotiyot Brachot. My friend, I think that all the curse that Bilam said through his mouth, and all the curse, all what he said, you know, he was a big prophet, he said them with bad thoughts. You know what happened, my friend? Something extraordinary. All those letters, all those words that came out from his mouth, they were flying. And Hashem, he turned them on good, that nothing would happen. Do you understand? This is one of the biggest things that Hashem did with us. Bilam HaRasha, he wanted to burn the Jews, he wanted to kill them. But what Hashem did, all the words that they came from his mouth, and because they've been written the Torah, Hashem made them, he changed the letters. He changed the letters from those bad letters, he made them good letters for the good of the Jews. That is a big sufferance to Bilam. To see all what he did, it's become good for the Jews. It's a big chesed that Hashem did to the Bnei Israel. It's extraordinary. My friend, I would like to tell you something. Be'ezat Hashem, in a few weeks, Tisha B'Av. A few weeks. Now, we are Tammuz. Then, when we start Tammuz, so we are not far away from Tisha B'Av. And you know what it is, Tisha B'Av? Tisha B'Av, it's we mourn the destruction of the Beth Hamikdash. The Gemara said, why the Beth Hamikdash was destroyed? And the Gemara said, the Beth Hamikdash was destroyed because the Jews didn't respect Torah, didn't respect Shabbat. But my question was, how is it possible that Hashem destroyed his house? Have you seen in your life a king to destroy his palace? This is something that it was hard for me to understand. The destruction of the house of Hashem. Hard for me to understand this. I mean, okay, Hashem could punish them. There's a lot of ways how to punish them. But why to destroy the Beit HaMikdash? The temple, the first one, the second one. My friend, I was thinking that Hashem, he destroyed the Beit HaMikdash, and I think it's for the good of the Jews that Hashem did that. Because now Hashem, he told the Jews, from now on, you don't have the Beit HaMikdash, but you are you. Every Jew is like a Beit HaMikdash. Like the Pasuk said, Ve'asuni mishkan v'shchati b'docham. Hashem, he said, build me a temple and I will reside on you. That means, now Hashem, he said, well, now I have you. And Baruch Hashem, there is no sacrifice today, but there is Torah. I think, my friend, when the Beit HaMikdash was getting burned, all the Torah that it was in the Beit HaMikdash, all the holiness that it was in the Beit HaMikdash, all the sacrifice that it was in the Beit HaMikdash, all what happened in the Beit HaMikdash during the 1,000 years that the Beit HaMikdash was existing, it became like letters. The letters are flying. The Beit HaMikdash is burning, but the letters of the mitzvot that they have been done in the Beit HaMikdash are flying. And then, all what we need now, just to catch them. How we catch them? By studying Torah, by reaching to be close to Hashem. This is the way. So, like the prophet said, Shafach Hashem hamato ha'etzim al banim. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he passed his anger on stone and on wood. That means the Beit HaMikdash that it was with stones and wood. And there, Baruch Hashem, Am Yisrael Hai. How is Hai? How Am Yisrael is Hai? Because Am Yisrael, Baruch Hashem, they've taken advantage of the Torah. My friend, on Tisha B'Av, we are not allowed to study Torah. It's funny. The Beit HaMikdash was destroyed because we did not respect the Torah. So the reparation should be to study Torah. So how come that on Tisha B'Av we sit on the floor, we mourn the destruction of Beit HaMikdash, and we don't study Torah? Why? We're supposed to study Torah. My friend, Hashem wants to remind us, I think. Did you catch the letters of the Torah when the Beit HaMikdash was burned? All the letters were flying. Did you catch them? So if you didn't catch them, so this is your punishment, that you don't study the Torah. Now make sure, after Tisha B'Av, you will start a new life of Torah. It's like when I want to punish my son. How I punish him? I put sweets, chocolate, games on the table. That's what the children love. And I tell him, look at them, but you don't touch them because you've been a bad boy. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he does the same to us on Tisha B'Av. Because of the Torah, the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed. Now that you can repair today, no, you don't repair. Think about all what you did, all year, all the Bitur Torah that you did, and think to catch back. It's a punishment. My friend, how much every one of us should remember that the Ezrat Hashem, every one of us today, he has a possibility. He has not to forget that Baruch Hashem, when we bury the tzaddik, the tzaddik is under the floor, but his Torah is outside the floor. Learn from him. You know, I was in Jerusalem yesterday, and I did two shiurim, one shiur to by Rav Bina, Nitiv Aryeh, and one by Havidat. But when I was in Nitiv Aryeh, Rav Bina showed me some boys. Told me this boys, this one, his parents, they are very rich, and his parents, they want him back home, but he wants to carry on to study Torah. And Rabbi David gave him a bracha, that his parents will lead him to carry on to study Torah. Imagine, my friend, a boy that was far away from Torah. And when he started to study Torah, he became another one. He showed him with somebody else that after the year, he's going to go to a big university. But at that university, there is no Jews there. So the rabbi was worried. Maybe he's a handsome boy, nice boy, maybe there he will lose his Judaism. So he told me, Rabbi David, please give him a bracha. So I give him a bracha. And you know what the boy said? Amen. Pray for me that my father will not let me go there. So I told him, you can talk to your father. There is no prayer. You can talk to him. He will listen to you. I'm sure he will listen to you. My friend, the Gemara said, "Im anili mili." If I don't do something for me, no one can do this. No one can do it for me. En hadavar talui elavi. Everything is up to me. I am here. I am a Beit HaMikdash. I am a Mishkan. I am the house of Hashem. I am everything. Hashem, He lives on me. Be Adonai. Hashem is on me. So just I have to do a move. And Be'ezat Hashem, everything will be good. Just a move. Just a simple move. Everything will be good. Be'ezat Hashem, I pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu to give you bracha ve'atzlacha, b'riut ve'at Hashem, parnasa tova. I pray to Hashem to protect you, and now I let you enjoy the tzaddikim, kibrit tzaddikim. And Hashem bless you. God bless you. Thank you very much.